dope on. Shit, the gray car is still here. Shit, gonna get that dope. They got to get that power. This is what we're talking about. Again, he's talking about a demilitarized area that Israel will have security power, but he's bringing in these other Arab nations, which through Abraham Accords, I believe, have been a little bit more willing to side with Israel because they all have a mutual enemy, and that's called Iran. So for now, they will enter into a truce. We've talked about this before. It's a strategy of Muhammad and Islam. And they will enter into a truce, a Huda, with the intent to break it later. This is building us towards what I believe to be really started, the accord and the agreement that the Antichrist will.
No, I wish they were building this truth.
It's still in process from what I understand, yes. The humanitarian aid that plays a big part in the initial help development of what's going on.
And who's going to rebuild Gaza then?
The world and the U.S., our tax dollars, without a doubt.
We are. I'm going to Tuesday. U.S. is going to rebuild it. Well, you're looking at us. That's how it goes. If our military contributes some, probably to it. But as with everything else in the world, the United States carries and pays for the biggest part of the bill. We have a huge national debt to show for it. We have needs here in this country that are foregone. And we will be foolish enough to do that. Israel could easily, in my opinion, rebuild and take care of that area if it was Israel. But as long as it remains a separate, quote-unquote, state, it's a disaster. But it's not just who's going to rebuild what's above ground. Who's going to rebuild what's underground?
We look at the picture that was placed alongside the Netanyahu put online, and you see a modern city with modern buildings and shipping on the waters right next to it, indicating this could be a beautiful and prosperous future for the Palestinian people. But sadly, we know from the Bible that's not going to be the case.
Well, America would put in as Josh said, the billions of dollars it takes to do that.
But I am concerned about this, though. Our nation, I believe, is under watch by the Lord for how we treat Israel. And we're seeing more and more come against Israel. Benjamin also, that speech he made yesterday dealing with remembrance, they said, as they said at Masada, never again. Meaning they will not sit down and commit suicide and allow themselves to be destroyed. They're going to stand in this, and they may end up standing alone. But we know that God is with them, in spite of the shortcomings that Israel may have had over its years. They are doing their best to stand now in a world that does not like them. And what this October 7th event did is it brought all the cockroaches into the light. So we can now see international much hatred there's prior to that it was there. But now it's been revealed. In this country, our support of Israel is waning. And if it continues on, as if the Lord should tarry, when our generations pass, that some of the older ones of us sitting here, this next generation is going after it.
Well, it's waning. It's waning because the support from the church is waning.
I agree. I think that's a sad situation. How many churches have taught what we have done in the last few months since October 7th? And we've done it many times on various programs about Israel. I compliment you and your wife and Donnie always bringing up things of Israel. But I've watched television, and there's a few, but not many. But how many churches around this country really are sharing what's going on with Israel?
A lot of churches on Sunday mornings, for example, thank God they do this. They will say, you know, pray for Israel. Let's remember Israel. You ask about teaching. I don't think that there's much. I don't especially. But those that have a media platform, it's just not happening. And I can say that because we're not seeing the nation in this direction. When the church gets it right, it doesn't just stay in the walls of the church. When the right teaching is going forth from the pulpit on a Sunday morning, it has an impact Monday through Saturday, whatever you want to say. But that's how we can know, ladies and gentlemen, because when the church gets it right and is preaching what's right, and we'll go back to it, if the church would just preach the cross, every aspect would be addressed, and that even includes giving elements of Bible prophecy and current events after. It's just that's the truth. But let me say this. Going through the Holocaust Memorial Museum, I was reminded. Yeah, Hashem. Yeah, it was that's an incredible experience. That is
it.
It, it, I've been to some other ones as well, but the ones in Washington, D.C., and in Jerusalem are incredible. But I was reminded, and it was made real to me, what took place leading up to the actual Holocaust and the sentiment that existed in Germany and throughout the world. And really, it wasn't Germany, it was all throughout Europe. And that exact same thing, I mean, Brother Spire, I felt like I was looking at headlines and current events, but it was from the 1930s. But I felt like I was looking at what was happening today, looking at the sentiment of the world, looking at the ship, the St. Louis, that came with so many Jews, thousands of Jews, that they were coming to Cuba. Cuba turned them away. And the United States said no. It was said that the Jews on that ship, they could see Florida. They could see the piers, the docks. They could see the land, the United States, the southern tip of Florida, so they were very close to the country of Cuba. They were that close to freedom. They were that close to life. But Roosevelt said, no, that ship was sent back. And every single one of those people ended up in a concentration camp.
Right.
So when I look at that, and I look at what's happening...
Because President Roosevelt did not want to upset her Hitler.
Yeah, well, President Roosevelt was acting... I don't want to be unkind, but I mean, the man was as cowardly as our president right now. But there were reasons, and I know at the time there were things going on, we could go into that, but the fact is, in my opinion, if the United States would have opened up the door to the Jewish people at that time, I don't believe we would have had a Pearl Harbor. I really don't. I believe it would have all been more than stopped. But we suffered greatly as a result.
I don't doubt that at all.
Swagger, as I sit and listen, I want to repeat something that Dave mentioned. I know we're moving on to text, but America.
The cross of Christ is the cement that holds this group covenant together. And but the grace of God rewards the preachers, but the thousands take it out.
Why did he start
preaching the cross?
Why did he add that note? Be not afraid. Some are fearful of this, brothers, for anxiety, fear. But he said, the Lord thy God is with thee. He's with you today.
Those who step out are going to see God move as they've never seen it move with you. Praise God. We've run out of time, ladies and gentlemen. But what a way to close the program. Thank you for being with us. Don't miss the next program. God bless you.
Thank you for joining us on today's program, The Message of the Cross. Watch program archives online at watch.sunlight.tv.
can be directed by the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. Well, what did the church today know of the Holy Spirit? There's a growing remnant of people who believe that the Book of Acts is a necessary blueprint for Christians today. Readers will discover what the Holy Spirit can accomplish through a believer's faith in Jesus Christ. In his debut book, Evangelist Donnie Swagger describes in detail the person, power, and role of the Holy Spirit. To order this book, go to shopjsm.org. If you love timeless gospel music that will bring joy to your heart, then you will love Studio Albums from Jimmy Swagger.
Jimmy Swagger Ministries. This is the Sun Life Broadcasting Network. him. against their acceptance of his message. The message was straight and to the point. Unless Nineveh repented, in 40 days, judgment would come. It is not stated exactly how this judgment would come, but evidently, knowing Jonah's experience, the Holy Spirit used this to bring about one of the few times in history that true repentance was forthcoming upon the announcement of impending judgment. The last two verses contain the great lesson of the book. Jonah needed the gourd which himself had not made, and grieved at his destruction. God created the inhabitants of Nineveh. His love needed them. How much greater, therefore, would be his grief and their destruction, as it is with any soul.
To order the Expositor's Word for Every Day daily devotional, call 1-800-288-8350 from the U.S. 0808-234-4941 from the U.K. All other locations, call 001-225-768-3500. Or get the Expositor's Word for Every Day daily devotional online at sunlifetv.com.
Peace. Thank you. Thank you. This is the story behind the song. Yes, it is. A look at the words and background stories that inspired the great Christian hymns of the church.
Welcome to another edition of the story behind the song. It's hard to believe that we have been doing this program for over 5 years. I'm back. I was watching this the other day.
Thank you.
Yeah.
when the roll is called up in the, I'm not quite sure exactly when James Milton Black wrote that song. I really couldn't find an exact date that he wrote it, other than I know that he wrote it in the early 1900s. Before I get into his life, I want to read a passage of scripture from the book of Revelation. This passage will play a singular central part in what prompted Brother Black to write this song. Revelation chapter 2, beginning of the first chapter. And I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. There was found no place for him. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Of course, this is the great white throne judgment. This great judgment of the damned will occur at the end of the great millennial reign. You can read that in Revelation chapter 20. It is contrasted with 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10 of another great judgment called the judgment seat of Christ. And this will take place right after the rapture of the church. And at the judgment seat of Christ, this is where all of the saints, all of us that have lived from the very beginning of time, that have made their calling and election sure, as well as those that are alive at the moment of the rapture, all that are saved, we will all stand before the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ, not to give an account for our salvation, because our salvation is settled, it is secure, but to give an account for our work for the Lord upon this earth. And this is where the believer will either receive rewards or no rewards, whatever the case may be. And so, this is obvious that we want to be at the judgment seat of Christ and not at the great white throne judgment. James Milton Black was born in Southfield, New York, in August of 1856. He was kind of a child prodigy. His parents and others around him in that little town of Southfield, New York, where he was born, recognized that from a very early age that he demonstrated a knack for singing, for playing, and for composing and arranging music. He was doing this from a very early age. And because of this, his whole focus from a child all the way up to the end of his life was focused around this gift of God that he was born with, this talent for music. And so all of his education was centered around music, piano, as well as he became a very accomplished organ player, singing, different parts, arranging music, composing music. After he finished his formal education, he went on the road for several years, and he would travel from town to town, and he would set up schools of music that would last 2, 3, sometimes 4 weeks. And what he would do is that he would charge a fee, a nominal fee, and all of the children of the village would come in, and he would teach them the rudimentary elements of music. And he would begin to teach them, give them voice lessons, finding out who could sing, who has the talent and ability. And then he would create a choir. And then he would also begin to identify those children in that particular town who had vocal abilities as a soloist. And then at the end of the school of music, whether it's 2 weeks or 3 weeks, he would put on a great concert where
the parents, family members, the city would come out, and they would take part of this. And he did this for several years, and he built up a reputation of being able to spot, to recognize young men and women that had vocal ability and musical ability. And no doubt, he probably set some on to a career in music. I don't know that for a fact, but it probably made it happen. But as well, when he wasn't putting these schools together, he was an editor of gospel songbooks. Matter of fact, one songbook that he oversaw from beginning to end, compiling the songs, editing them, putting it all together in the order that it should go, it was called Songs of the Soul. It proved to be so popular that it sold nearly 500,000 copies in the first 2 years of its publication. So he was establishing a reputation as someone, as a force, if you will, in the many facets of the music industry, a singer, a composer, an arranger, an accompanist, recognizing abilities and helping individuals with their careers. But in spite of all of this, that all took second place to his own personal devotion to the Lord Jesus Christ. James Black was a devout Methodist, a member of the Methodist Church his whole life. He had left New York. He was now living in Williamsport, Pennsylvania, and a member of that one of the Methodist churches there in Williamsport. And we know Williamsport. That's where the Little League World Series is played. And he was a Sunday school teacher. Not only that, he was the president of their youth group in the Methodist Church called, I think it was called the Young People Society, that's what they called it. And he was the director of the youth ministry there in that local Methodist Church. But he had a special affinity in dealing with young people, of finding that young man, that young woman, who was broken, who came from an unhappy situation, whether it was a divorce, whether it was tragedy, whether it was some type of impediment that they suffered from, something that caused them in their own mind to be an outcast in their society, their peer group. And he just had a knack for knowing the right thing to say at the right time to bring them hope, cheer, and encouragement. And he was successful at seeing the lives of many young people that were facing very difficult situations and bringing them out of it with the help of the Lord and his knowledge of the Word of God and his love for music. This great song that we're going to do, that we're doing today, came about as he was dealing with one of these young people. He came in contact with a young girl in the city. She was not a part of the church. She was not a part of the Young People Society. Her father was the town drunk. He was a total embarrassment to the family. And she wore this as a badge of shame. She stayed in the shadows, if you will. Her father, so many times, the family having to go get him as he literally could not walk, and they had to bring him home. The embarrassment, the shame, the ridicule that the family suffered because of this. And you know, young people, these things can pierce their heart and soul, hurt them to such a degree that it weighs on them. It destroys. And that's the condition of this young girl. The Holy Spirit led him to this girl, and he began to talk to her. And he invited her to the Young People Society, to the youth meeting. And lo and behold, not only that, but after a few weeks of coming just to the young people's meetings, on her own, she started coming to church Sunday morning, Sunday night. And before long, she accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. He was so elated, so excited. And they came one night to the youth meeting, and he always had a habit. First of all, he would always assign the students the meaning, a scripture verse to memorize. And then when they would come back the next week, each person would give the verse that he would assign them. And then, before they would do that, he would call the roll. He literally had a list of the students, and he would call their name. They would stand up and say, "Here, I'm here." And then they would give the verse that he had assigned to them. They would go to God. So one night at one of the meetings, and I think he was late coming in, and he didn't really pay attention to the group that had gathered that night, and he began to call the roll. He called this young lady's name, and there was no answer. He called it again. There was no response. He looked up once. She wasn't there. He finished out calling out the roll, and he went through the service that night. But the fact that she wasn't there troubled him. The meeting is over. He's going home. And all of a sudden, as he is on his way home, this 20th chapter of Revelation, the gloom, the horror of not being in the Book of Life, contrasted with the joy that will be experienced at the judgment seat of Christ. And he said, "Lord, I hope and I pray and I promise you that no matter what happens, when I get to heaven, when the roll is called up in the
end, I'll be there."
You don't want to go there. church went to the home and found out that the reason why Mary was not in service was because she had a horrible case of pneumonia. Even to the point that the doctor said, without a miracle, she got in there. Well, she didn't. In a few days, her body wrapped with this pneumonia. But when she died, she had the assurance of knowing that her name was written in the Lamb's Book. Well, that's the story behind James Milton's great composition, and the role is called That's what we're going to bring you. Now, we're not doing it in the version of the hymn book, because we don't really do hymn book versions of part of the song that way. We kind of interpret it in our own style and our own way. And I think it's going to be a blessing. So, heard the story. Now, let's hear when the roll is called.
Okay.
I like what you send me. Well, that's kind of cool. No complaint. I don't want to fit it, though. And thank you, I won't.
I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that he died on the cross and shed his blood for me. And on the third day, he rose out of that tomb victorious over death, hell, and the grave. Right now, I accept Jesus Christ.
Oh, what you're going to hear the same thing you've been hearing, foolishness, so evil. Yes, they do know. Appeals power. And they all do it.
If you didn't know the Lord, I wouldn't be praying that.
But thank you, I can do what, Lord? Show the truth.
Be sure to tune in with us for the next edition of Story Behind the Sorrow.
And face ugly faces to go with it. Bodies, too. Talk about bad bodies. Everybody been thrown away. Yeah, that's a cute skirt. It was showing up, but it was cute. That wasn't good. I should have checked it.
That smoke, it smells and sounds, smell right.
You got some more popping over there. By saying something different with it, Lord. Sin is sin, evil is evil. It's all the same.
Thank you.
know you later.
Yeah, that's true. Especially if you didn't know. Then dress, let's do a tea.
Yeah.
down.
I appreciate it. Shit. Sorry. Sorry, little boy. Why she did that, man? I'm laughing where the Lord knows. Make a fool of themselves. And I was sick too. Lord, thank you. The firefighter said, she said it happened before. Shit. Say old from new. Lord Jesus, thank you. Then this clown
This is Immoral by another one. I want to say, name them. We love that too. We know y'all know each other. Evil. Still no good. Or freedom. Lord Jesus, thank you. Can't thank you enough. It's foolishness. Oh no. Lord, thank you. I forgot about that, but you guys, it's just foolishness. It's like, no, I didn't do it, none of that. Please direct the evidence to the police. Lord Jesus, thank you. Keep leading me, I will follow. And thank you for the pastor. I was with them then too. Really, with just months after moving in here, I've been with them. Thank you. Just foolishness. The same for what y'all. Lord, thank you. Well, she was doing so. You was being exposed continuously. Just foolish, Lord Jesus, like you. This is pretty weird. Lord, thank you. I forgot about that. But if that happened again, bring it back to my memory. Just foolish, dude. You had me to speak. Both times. The officer right there. She didn't even see the officer. I didn't either. But you had him placed right where it needed to be. You're just foolish. But thank you. I believe I do have those memories. Thank you to me. Lord, thank you. She didn't say nothing. No, that didn't happen. I didn't do that. He didn't do that. Just foolishness. Lord Jesus, thank you. Tell me to say how the boy put the gun in his pants? Just foolishness. Trying to intimidate me. Just foolishness. Lord Jesus, thank you. And thank you, place who you placed there. I still remember who the officer was. The fire chief, he was mad at her. This foolishness. But she didn't care this. She still don't. Just give her some dope and let her get beat. And come on back. She's going to get some pills. And that crack. Lord Jesus, thank you. I called the police out here for them. No, we knew they wouldn't. Dancing in distress, they was deserving. Oh, I watched them get beat, didn't I? Listen, didn't I, Lord? And thank you. But this hoe want to say, I called the police. She's a fool. You see for what you are, too. Lord Jesus, thank you. And not no hoe with no God, there's a hoe on scene. And dope, all the time. Immoral. Lord, thank you. Exposing for what they are. Lying tongue, everything. She ain't turning down no sin.
Okay, they are.
Lord, thank you. Bring that back to my, well, I don't want the smoke to go off, but if it does, bring that back, or anytime.
just foolishness. And he asked her, what, Lord? And she said, no, just foolishness. Thank you. I know that was written down. Lord Jesus, thank you.
And then pretty about sin. And then you see him. She up there. She posts it up too. Many videos. And God's good, he had both of them together too in the video. Talking about mail, she got that for me. Put in respect to her mother. Just foolishness. All the children dragging them across the floor. They crying out. Just foolishness. But he do dope with her. He said, come on, be there, live with her now. Well, he was living here too with took her children out in the cold with no coat. He had his leather coat on. He wasn't gonna be like the weather. Just foolishness. Lord Jesus, thank you. And he do the same thing like that. Well, they do the same thing, stomping, dropping, the same thing. I'm glad she opened her big nasty mouth. Call names. Lord Jesus, thank you. Tell the tale and I'll tell the truth of it. Lord Jesus, thank you. But we're back up. I don't think she saw the police at all. But you did have a place right where they need to be. I didn't see till it was turned coming out. It still came on in. Just like, did you hear that? Because I never did. It was foolishness. You should just say, no, I didn't do that. That didn't happen. Yeah, it did. And how many times they came out here? Just foolishness. Slashing tires. Just foolishness. But they still together. She was a fool to put the car in his hand. Now be together, it was justified. They both were fools. Well, that was a foolish action. Jesus, thank you. It's foolish. But she came in thinking she gonna do something. Pull your big ass on. Rotund. That's condemned. That's all you got. Oh, and Mecca. Lord Jesus, I understand you can agree with others. There's nothing worse than the understanding of all sinners saved. But yet, in some cases, it's higher than all. Those that are true. No, because they belong. We've seen that. Thank you, Lord, for those blessings. But they got that price anymore. Thank you. Oh, thank you.
What do I do? It's a man. He's been in his life. That was church. He was a deacon there.
sorry, little boy. That's very sensitive too. We know the battery's good.
Yes.
Lord, thank you.
Beautiful picture.
Yeah,
stuff that's me that he's been on.
This, this shepherd's, he's white, he's gray, he's gray and then he's white. There's only one thing that's red and white at the same time, and that is the Lamb of God that is slain. And I, what I read in the Song of Solomon, you cannot read it as a narrative. Every verse has its own revelation. Every section has its own revelation. And I did the same thing. First time I heard Song of Solomon, I was, well, first time I was, I think 2 years ago when I started the ministry, I was reading the Bible, I got the Song of Solomon, and I said, I love you, Lord. This is the weirdest book I've ever seen. This is for somebody else. That's not that me. I'll just read it because I have to, and then I'll skip over. And then I went to a pastor's seminar in Florida, and a man got up and said, I listened to you wondering about the Song of Solomon. And said, it's a message to help strengthen our marriages. Because that man read the Bible.
Jimmy from Illinois, you're on the
I like neck bones, as long as they're meaty. Well, I guess also cook, right? Yes, it is.
Closest
to the original translation that we can get
my
to.
Great grandma used to say that, don't get anybody with that.
Say this, the Geneva Bible, it's not
the Lord,
bad
thank you, I believe. And did just that.
It's, I'm not even 50, but yes.
It hasn't been updated either. It
hasn't been updated, so I don't know, unless he's got the names mixed up. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen, we have one in the office, but I don't think I've ever seen one for sale. I had one. I don't know where it but I had it.
It came out with a count on the screen.
Yeah.
In Geneva, which okay.
But you know, what you need to do the next time she tells you don't need to be reading that, you say, well, you don't need to be reading that. So we're not going to probably agree on this. So you read what you want to read, and I'll read what I want to read. And that's just the way you're going to have to leave it.
Yeah, okay. I appreciate that.
Take from it is that we have to be in agreement with the Lord. first and foremost, it's not him coming into agreement with us. It's us coming into agreement with him. And if we're agreement on some things and disagreement in others, how can we walk together? There's really no fellowship there. Because fellowship comes on the basis of agreement. How would you guys come
out to walk together if they're going opposite directions?
But that's what, you know, this is, you know, Amos is prophesying to and against and for Israel. He's reminding them of, you know, basically you're in a mess because you got yourself in this mess. And we've got to take a break. We'll be right back with our next caller.
Make your
know that the kingdom in heaven is going to be moved down to earth during the millennial reign. And the new Jerusalem will be built. It'll be 1,500 miles square, 1,500 miles high. That's where the throne will sit. And the millennial temple,
and
will be rebuilt by the millennial temple. And worship will go on there. And so everything will be moving from heaven in the planetary bodies of space to this earth. And it'll be the new Jerusalem. Any other comments, gentlemen, on that that you would like to add to that? I hope that answers your question. Jerusalem will be the center of God. That will be the capital of the world, like, there will be nations in the world. Now, we don't know what the names will be. There will still be commerce. This is for those that are not in their glorified body. And so there are two types of people that will be on the earth during that time. The glorified saints, and then those that are in the natural body. And the natural body people are those that are left on the earth at the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so they will be spread or flung all around the globe. Like I said, I don't know if the countries and the borders will be the exact same as today. The Bible doesn't give us indication one way or the other on that. And I don't know if there'll still be different languages. My personal opinion is that we'll have, even those in the natural body, somehow will be given the ability to communicate. I don't see that language being a barrier on this earth, but we don't know that, and so I don't want anybody speculating on all that. This is me thinking. But the world's attention and will be focused on Jerusalem.
Revelation 21 and 22, the new earth.
And if you read those two chapters in Revelation, that will help.
Okay, well, I'm
feel
a little fast about, so this new heaven and new earth.
Oh, sure, and the Son and the Holy Spirit
will be in the new heaven and new earth.
It's coming down here, and we know that God is moving his kingdom from heaven to this earth.
Okay, that was what I was confused about.
Yeah.
Can I ask one more question?
Sure, yes, ma'am.
Okay, why do you think there's no reference? Well, I guess there is, maybe I've overlooked it. Concerning David's mother.
Her name? I know who she is. The Bible says her name's Nahash. She's the mother of Abigail and Zeruiah. So she must be the mother of David also. And she is not the same mother as David's seven brothers when you read the chronology.
Yeah.
And, you know, and the Bible doesn't give us all of the chronological, down through the generations. It gives us some genealogy, but many times some of the individuals talking about the Bible doesn't tell us anything about mothers, fathers, or even spouses that much. So that's just the way that it is.
And Nahash could be her maiden name.
Yeah.
It could be her maiden name. We don't know exactly what that name is a derivative from, but it does say she's the mother of Abigail and Zeruiah.
And, you know, again, I wouldn't say much, but Psalms 86:16, David would say, "Save me, because I serve you just as my mother did." And so we know, we don't know much about her, but we do know that she loved God.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much for answering my question.
Well, thank you, Ann, for calling. Our next email, can you please explain exactly what the scripture means when it says not to judge? I had told my friend it was wrong for her to lie on an application for an apartment because she technically did not make enough to get the apartment. I sent her the scripture where it says that one of the things that God hates is, I'm assuming she's speaking of lying,
She was not thrilled with what I told her, and she told me he forgives, which I agree. I apologize to her if I did more harm than good, but I would like to know what judging. Okay, first of all, you're not judging her. You do not have to, you do not owe her an apology. You told her the truth. Truth never has to be apologized for, ever. And that's not judging. It doesn't fall in the art of judging. This is your friend was committing an act of what we would call willful sin. They knew that what they were putting down on that paper was not right, and they didn't deceive someone in order to gain something. And if she claims to be a Christian, she got problems. And you are not wrong in any stretch of the imagination. You do not owe her an apology, and you did not judge her. Judging is when you look at, when you try to judge the motive of someone. We don't know a person's motive. We don't know the pressure they're under or whatever the case, but we can and must judge the fruit, the action. We can judge that. The Bible makes it very clear on that, gentlemen.
Most people refer to Matthew chapter 7 where it says, judge not, and say you're not supposed to judge anything.
But that's well, not what that means.
Yeah, the Bible talks about it.
Don't guess you'll be right along with them.
And as you said, we judge fruit behavior.
Yes, Lord.
You better check out who's working on your car and make some judgments about their qualifications or repairing your refrigerator or your grocery store. We make judgments all the time. But it's important to condemnation.
You cannot live without making judgments. Every single
well, they say, oh, God is judging me. That's just saying you're going to hell. She's foolish. Thank you, Pastor.
Our judgment is wrong. But it's based on the information we have, and we get more information and we correct it.
You know, there's probably two ways to define the word judge and judgment.
You know, all you're hearing is they evil.
The other one is to assign a punishment. Judges today making a decision and they assign a punishment. That's not what the church does. That's God's job.
Right.
If they do, they don't.
To simply evaluate.
How to appeal.
And respect the fruit, so to speak. The Bible does say, let the elders judge. For let me, I mean, you have to evaluate and discern. Right.
And the gray car is still here.
Every situation. Okay, from Oklahoma, you're on the air. Okay. You're on the air.
Okay, thank you.
I read the road, dog.
I certainly just want to say, Thomas Solomon, I see that as one of the greatest love stories in the Bible. I know a love story is what Jesus, he gave you all for me. And in another version, I like the Thomas Solomon, because to me, that is nothing but a love story. And so I just want to comment on that. But after the last few days, I'd love to call about crazy people that just call in. I don't know how you can listen to the radio, but you've got a great chance for that.
They want
to complain about where we stand, about when we vote, and how you possibly stand for this or stand for that. And they say, oh, I'm such a born-again Christian. But they need to listen to other people besides you. You're not the only one that's telling them to get out and live right, to vote right, according to the Bible, not according to a person. Pastor Hagee, he's very verbal on this subject. Well, I go to church, it's very verbal. You need to get out. You've got to do it according to the word of God. And if we don't vote, we're going to be held accountable. And I just want to say, I don't understand how some of these people can call in and tell you that they're born again and how they see things. I just think.
Well, it's because, okay, let me just be very straightforward. You've got millions of people that call themselves Christian and go to church, but they're no more born again than I would. They have a philosophy of Christianity, but they don't let the Word of God rule their life. They don't let the Word of God direct the affairs of their life. They don't seek the face of the Lord for counsel and direction. They vote because of the color of their skin, or their bank account, or their parents' influence upon them, or family pressures, or community pressures. There are a multitude of reasons, but none of that matters. What matters is, what does God say? And we know that God is not the author of bad government. God created government. Secondly, we know that God does not approve of transgenderism, same-sex marriage, abortion. He doesn't approve of that. And a person who calls himself a Christian, and yet they align themselves with candidates, politicians, and political parties that not only advocate those things, but are openly, in the language of their platform, hostile toward Christians. How can two walk together?
Unless they agree.
Except they be agreed.
Well, I believe that was sound, don't you?
How can two walk together? And so these people are going to have to give an account, because here's what they don't want to hear. When they vote for a party, a platform, or a candidate that is endorsing those things, they are condoning those sins. Number two, they're entering into those sins. Number three, they are saying, I know more than God knows. And, you know, and when you deal with people like that, most of the time you can't deal with them. They're not going to change. You can just, all we can do is just keep saying what I'm saying, and keep saying what I'm saying, and keep saying what I'm saying. And there will be some that will allow the Holy Spirit to open their eyes. Unfortunately, Kay, I don't have hope for my heart. That's why it's important for us that we believe in us, that we all love. We don't take the attitude of every single vote counts in every single election, whether it's for a school board or whether it's for the president of the United States. But thank you for calling on that. I appreciate your comment. Please explain 1 John 5:16. 1 John, and it says, if any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him wine from him who sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for him. Let me just read the book. Let's go back to the beginning and let's read the notes out of this father's study Bible. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, refers to correction other than the cross done ignorantly while they're compassionate with everybody. When you read the book of Leviticus, Deuteronomy, and read the Old Testament laws, it talked about sins of ignorance. And what it's meaning here in 1 John is that their ignorance is not in regards, as the rest of the verse will bear out, against the cross. The meaning of Christ, why he came to do what he did. And really, a lot of this pertains to what did you do when you voice in. I think a lot of this goes to new believers. New believers that they're not. In their new walk with the Lord, that which they're doing is contrary to the Word of God. That's why, personally, then he said there is a sin unto death. Now, what is that sin unto death? Well, that is the sin of turning your back on Christ and Him crucified, rejecting the means of salvation, and accepting another means. You know, I'm studying the book of Colossians right now. In Colossians, the Colossian church was being ripped apart by three things. Number one, asceticism. There were those in the church trying to please God by denying themselves of personal pleasures. Now, I'm not talking about personal pleasures that are sinful. Number two, legalism. We know what legalism is trying to sanctify and live for God according to man-made rules and regulations, or your own rules and regulations, by passing
what he's talking about, Gnosticism there, which dispense with the word of God. We're on a higher level. We have more knowledge. If you have faith, we have knowledge.